Okay, we are back on the record in the Voss and Knight matter, cause number 20-3-178-23. Ms. Voss, how do you wish to proceed?
I'd like to call my next witness, Your Honor.
Okay.
And that's Nathan Quick.
If you want to go get him, yeah. Please come forward. You come right through there, yes. You're going to come over here. And before stepping up on that step, I want you to raise your right hand. You solemnly swear affirm the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please come up and have a seat. I'd like to have you begin by stating your name and then spelling your last name for the record.
Nathan Click, C-L-I-C-K.
Okay, so Ms. Voss, you may inquire.
Thank you, Your Honor. Good afternoon, Nathan, or Mr. Click. I'm so accustomed to calling you Nathan, I apologize if I go between the two. Where do you work?
At Catholic Community Services.
And what is your job title?
Clinical Care Coordinator.
Okay, and do you work within the WISE program?
I do.
And do you have, as the case coordinator for WISE, do you work with both youth?
Which youth?
I'm sorry. Do you work with Haven Knight and Rice Knight?
I do.
So you coordinate each of their individual teams? Is that correct? Do you have special training in this area?
Yes.
How many WISE teams have you been involved with?
Define WISE teams. Are you looking for how many, I apologize, how many WISE interventions?
Yes.
I've been a part of specific families I've worked with. With my core team, I have been involved with somewhere between 20 and 35 families.
Okay. With your core team and?
Maybe one or two with other teams.
Okay.
I don't recall specifically.
And with respect to Hayden and Rice, are you with your core team or is this?
It's a modified team.
And can you describe those modifications?
I was actually added to this case following the removal of the originally signed care coordinator, Rhea Hatton, and was added on to her core team at that time. And beyond that, further modifications have been made of the removal of Davida Stafford as therapist with the replacement of Asiel Aspirin as clinician.
Okay, and we'll get back to that later, but so are you familiar with both Mr. Knight and myself?
I am.
As well as the children?
Yes.
And do you feel that you have a good relationship with both parents?
I feel that I have a adequate relationship with both parents to do the work that I do.
Okay.
Yes.
A good working relationship then. Get along. So I would suspect, and then correct me if I'm wrong, that your aim is to maintain a positive or productive working relationship with both parties even after you testify today. Is that correct?
Could you restate your question?
I guess what I'm wondering is, will your testimony be maintain productive relationships with both parties?
It will not.
Okay. So, I've got some exhibits I'd like to show you. The new exhibit 391 that I brought in today. Can I get that?
You may. I need to show Mr. Nyquist.
Identify what it is that we are looking at.
Generally, yes. I don't recall this specific email.
Okay. And so, I'm sorry, when I ask you to identify for the court record what is it that we are looking at?
Thank you. Communication from Bobby Knight to Cynthia Johnson and yourself, Andrew Voss. Cynthia Johnson being the GAL assigned to the case. Yeah. Oh, this is from my supervisor, Joseph Darborough. I apologize.
And in this, if you look at, first, he attaches three documents on the second page, is that correct?
He does.
And do the documents that follow the email appear familiar to you?
The first two are familiar to me. The third, labeled Wise Families, I'm familiar with the content, but I haven't seen this specific document.
So you're familiar with the Wise Juvenile Courts, but not the Wise Families?
I apologize. The final packet, I have not seen these specific documents before.
Okay. Do they appear to be flyers about the WISE program?
Yes.
And since you haven't had the time to look at them, maybe you could just look at them briefly and see if they encompass what you understand the program to entail, or if certain aspects seem correct, or if anything appears incorrect to your knowledge. I guess I'm referring just to the first nine pages there.
Yeah. Excluding the referral form?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We'll talk about that separately.
do believe these documents are accurate.
Okay, thank you. And then going back to the first email, where Mr. Knight forwarded this email from Joseph Darborough to myself, Ms. Johnson. Do you indicate, or do you see towards the bottom, second last paragraph, it says, it sounds like what you may be looking for is recommendations from a behavioral health provider concerning your children's placement or recommendations for their parenting plan. We don't do that?
Yes.
Okay. Is that, well, I understand you weren't a part of this email. Is that message ring true with your initial understanding of this case? That Mr. Knight was looking for recommendations about placement or recommendations for the parenting plan?
I cannot speak to Mr. Knight's conversations with Joseph Darborough.
Sure.
But I would agree with Mr. Darborough's statement that our interventions are not designed to in any way support the child placement process beyond the support, of the individual parties.
Okay. Thank you. And as we turn back to the Wise families, I think it's five pages in, where it says Wise principles.
Okay.
Are those the principles that you're familiar with?
They are.
Okay. And can you explain, before I go there. In this case, we have two children of two different ages, correct?
Correct.
And Hayden, at the age of 14, has certain rights, is that correct?
Yes.
And Rice, who is about a month shy of 13, hasn't quite attained those rights, is that correct? In regard to mental health decision making.
Rice has a different set of rights, yes.
Okay. And so where it says family and youth voice and choice at number one, what does that look like with respect to Hayden's team?
With respect to Hayden's team?
Yes.
Early on in the process, Hayden and I had a conversation regarding his intervention, and he indicated to me through a series of yeses and nos that he would like his mother to be the primary parent on his intervention, being that he is 13 years old. He has, after talking to supervisors, I was directed to follow his request, being that he is 13 years old and is covered by a separate set of rights regarding privilege and access to mental health in Washington State. And we moved forward with that intervention, as with Angie as the primary role, and incorporating Bob in the times and the places that we could. Yeah.
And when you say mom as primary, are you getting directions specifically from me, or is this sort of Hayden's team and Hayden's direction on things? I guess the question is it my input that's being considered, or are there medical decisions that I'm making regarding his health care?
Our interventions always focus, or always are intended to focus, rather, on the voice of the youth first. Parents' voices are always considered in addition to and in support of the youth. Hayden indicating that he would like you as the primary parent in his intervention is not necessarily typical within our interventions to have one parent excluded or included outside of, I guess, the normal family structure, if that makes sense. So, yeah, I think I answered the question.
I think so, with respect to Hayden's team.
Yes.
And so, how does that look differently on Rice's team?
Rice's team, because Rice is not 13, Rice's intervention is technically led by a parent with the voice and choice of the youth considered with the greatest possible weight, since our interventions are designed to be youth and family focused. Rice's specific circumstance is that after conferring with supervision and the higher-ups within our organization, they believed that the best adherence to the current parenting plan and rights as they are were to continue with Bob as the primary parent on Rice's intervention based on Rice's age.
And was that Rice's request that Mom be excluded? Or was that Mr. Knight's request?
At no point that I remember was a request made specifically for exclusion. I don't recall the specific circumstances.
Okay. And so the last couple of pages of this exhibit, have you seen this referral form before?
I have.
Okay. And have you had the opportunity to discuss this with him?
I have not.
Okay. Is it your understanding? I guess, why not? Why is this not something that you would have discussed with Hayden?
The specifics of the referral forms are used for screening in to our services, and we rarely refer to them beyond the original CANs and intake with the team. One could consider them internal documents, if you will. Also, there's usually a good amount of gap, usually, between the admission of a referral form and the admission of a youth to the program. So while the information may still be up to date, getting it with fresh ears upon intake is within our system.
Okay. I'd like to move on to the Catholic Community Services WISE records, but we've got the exact same records in two different formats, and I'm wondering which would be preferred. We've got Exhibit 343 that was put together by Ms. Pietro-Rubles, which is Catholic Community Service records for Hayden. And we've also got Exhibit 58 from my original submission and your 904.
Which is it you want to address?
And so, let's address Exhibit 343 first, and I will just illustrate the differences between the two and see if Mr. Knight has any objection. So exhibit 343 is hand numbered, and it is strictly related to Hayden's intervention with records, part of which were ER-904s under exhibit 58, and some are new records. So
question is 58, was that an amended 904? Because I don't see it on my objection list. My objection list only goes to 57.
You were served with the second or the supplemental.
So my question, Ms. Voss, are you intending to have this exhibit admitted under your 904 submission, or are you intending otherwise? And if you are intending to have it, we need to. I just need to know that. How are you?
Right, right.
Okay.
And I'm trying to get at that as quickly as possible, Your Honor. So my intent, my preference would be to use exhibit 343 because.
Okay. So you will not be intending to try to do it under 904.
Well, if there are objections, I would fall back on the other. I just would like to point out that there was no objection.
I'm just asking, go ahead and proceed.
Okay.
I do have an objection.
Well, it hasn't been offered yet, so it's good to know that that's an issue, though. Okay. So go ahead, Ms. Voss.
That's what I was trying to figure out. So we can't do a hypothetical if I offer. I know there was no objection. I don't recall an objection to 58. So I'd like to offer 343, knowing that it's the same thing.
You'll need to have it identified.
Oh, wait, I apologize. So,
objection, Your Honor. There's redacted information throughout this whole stack.
Well, it hasn't been offered yet, and so let's work through the foundational parts, and then once it's offered, you can raise your objections.
And proceed.
Wait for the next question.
Okay, so do you recognize this, at least the first page of this?
I do.
Okay, and can you identify it? And again, what is the title date?
This is a records request submitted by Angie Voss to FBH office staff Carmen Catan on the 25th of January of this year.
Okay. And do you recognize some of the pages that follow as Catholic Community Service records for Hayden?
Yes.
And do you see on the first page there, it has some information about some things being private and some things being redacted?
On the page following the records request?
No, it's here somewhere. Yes, I believe so. That's the ROI.
you specify where you're finding this text?
I'm terribly sorry, but reading things on paper versus in person.
Mm-hmm.
I'm afraid I can't find it specifically here. But is it your general understanding that certain information is privileged and will not be released to apparent requesting records?
I am not specifically familiar with our legal policies, but from my experience, that does seem to be true.
Okay. And so, again, do you see any reason why this exhibit is not, I see later on it says redacted for confidentiality, several on the last half, and then in the preceding pages, it looks like that might have shifted down in the copy.
Yes.
Okay.
On the third, fourth page under confidential sensitive clinical materials.
Thank you. So again, I'd like to offer exhibit 343.
Any objection?
Yes, to the redactions.
Any particular, so?
So there's, right in the middle here. But,
what page are you looking at, sir?
It appears to be 51.
Okay.
Right in the middle of my test, where I'm talking to the person, they've redacted a bunch of stuff. So how is any of this going to be testifiable?
So, Ms. Voss, the objection is on the issue of completeness. Your response?
My response is that, as is indicated, some of this is confidential, excuse me, and sensitive clinical materials. So, the records have been redacted for confidentiality purposes, and I'm of the same mind that I'd like to know what Mr. Knight said to DeVita Stafford when is this, June 28th. But I couldn't get this information either because it's confidential. Mr. Knight's statements to the therapist, I can't have access to. And so, I believe it is an exception, and I'm sorry, let me add that I did request that that Mr. Click be subpoenaed for the unredacted portions in case the court, or in case an objection did arise, and that did not occur. necessary. I would ask that the witness provide, and I have a list of which pages are redacted and which may need to be looked at to make this complete or the on-camera review process.
I'm looking at the rule 106. And that is when a writing or recorded statement or part thereof is introduced by a party, an adverse party may require the party at that time to introduce any other part or any other writing or recorded statement which ought, in fairness, to be considered contemporaneously with it. So that's the issue. What I'm hearing is that you have made the attempt. What I'm also hearing is that is potential that that is available.
I'm sorry, potential.
It's potential that that is available.
Available, yes. And again, the other exhibit, the year 904, I don't know that he made the same objection to that.
As I indicated earlier, we go either one way or the other
way.
I don't. I don't have this. It's either 904 or it's being offered. Right now it's being offered. What I did not hear and I want to be specific. What I did not hear was any inquiry for foundation, whether these documents were made for the purposes of medical diagnosis or treatment, describing medical history or past and present systems, pain or sensations, or the inception or general character of the cause or external source thereof related to a diagnosis or treatment. I didn't hear anything that came from this witness on those issues with regard to this document.
I understand, Your Honor. May I inquire?
You may inquire.
Thank you. Were these records created for the purpose of diagnosing and treating mental health of Haydenite?
They were.
Thank you. And did they also include medical history, background information, and other treatment? So for the purpose of treating Haiti?
Most likely.
Outside of the rule of completeness, Mr. Knight, any further objections?
No, sir.
The court is going to admit Exhibit 343 as a medical record under evidentiary rule 803. on the rule of completeness, which is evidentiary rule 106, this is admitted subject to the complete record being provided with regard to the redactions, inasmuch as those redactions are removable, okay? I note that there are some references to last names that have been redacted, and I don't know whether they can be disclosed. So I will consider that, and I'll leave it to you, Ms. Knight, to provide the unredacted portions.
Clarification, sir.
Just a moment. And I say that, and we should probably be looking at redaction by redaction, instead of just a global decision from this court, because the one that was pointed out by Mr. Knight, I do think, has some substance to it. I'm not sure about the other redactions. It may just be a last name, and in those circumstances, I'm not so certain I would require that. Okay, so Mr. Knight.
Just a clerical issue. You referred to Ms. Voss as Ms. Knight, and I wanted to make sure that it was understood.
And I will continue to apologize for doing that, and I've done that I don't know how many times, and I've done it the other way around too.
Yes, sir.
I'm working not to do that, and I appreciate, and it's important for you to point that out. And I'm sorry if I offend, and I certainly am not being offended if you point it out. Okay. Outside of that, oh, wait a second. I see that there are email addresses being redacted. Mr. Knight, I'm going to give you the laboring oar on this. When it comes to these redactions, I want you to be, not this moment, okay, but I'm gonna want you to do some homework, take a look at this, and be very specific in those portions of these records that you think are not complete because of the redactions, because things such as an omitted email address, I don't see being an issue, or even a last name. It may, but I don't see that being an issue. But when it is a significant, what appears to be something in between something else, it appears that it influences the writing. I think that's a valid objection. Ms. Voss, you indicated that your intention was some sort of a workaround on this through a subpoena to have this portion before the court, and that hasn't occurred.
Correct.
I heard the rest of that too. And so I'll leave it to you to follow up on that issue and find out, because the burden's gonna be on you on the issue of completeness, okay? And so, and if you have limitations, you need to explain that to the court, but if you need a court subpoena, you can certainly request one.
And some of the redactions, again, are at the request of Hayden. Do I need to disclose that to Mr. Knight?
We're going to start with is Mr. Knight is going to go through this document and say these are the issues of completeness. These are the redactions that he takes exception to. Then I will hear from you as to what you're able to resolve on that. But the rule says the adverse party, which would be Mr. Knight, may require the party at that time to introduce any other part or any other writing or recorded statement, which ought to be in fairness to be considered contemporaneously. It could be that this redaction is a non-issue. I don't know.
Okay.
Okay, so with all of that, th- 343 is admitted subject to this court's requirement of completeness. So you may proceed.
Thank you. So, if we go back to the, okay, you've got a very large piece of paper, stack of paper in your hands, let's deal with that first. So we were talking about the composition of the different teams. In your experience, what do the best and most successful teams look like?
The elements for success, I think, are outlined pretty clearly in the handout in the previous exhibit of Family Voice and Choice. Focus on strengths as a pursuant solution to needs that are presented by the family, cooperation, communication.
And has it been the team's mission to increase the inclusiveness of each of the teams, to bring Mr. Knight's voice into or have some sort of mending, as it were, into Hayden's team and vice versa, bringing me closer into Bryce's team?
I would assume it's included in these records, the cross-system care plan. and no point do I recall stating a specific goal of reintegration in either Chloe or Rice, rather, or Hayden's cross-system care plan. I will say, however, that involving all family voices is at the core of the work that we do in WISE.
Okay.
And working toward that, whether stated or unstated, is an implicit goal in our work.
Okay. Do you recall ever having stated the hope is someday we get there, sort of?
I do recall making that statement to, I believe, both parties.
Okay. And so with that goal in mind, but not necessarily in paper, is what I'm hearing, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. What progress has been made on that front with regard to bringing me and my voice into Rice's team? Specifically?
Some progress has been made.
Okay, some. Can you be more specific?
Yes. As an example of improvement, both Mr. Knight and parties from the school encouraged me to work with you regarding your opinions and directives prior to the Youth 504 meetings that took place earlier this year, I believe. And that example, I think, shows the method of third parties being utilized to bring both parents' voices into their respective youth teams, team meetings that they aren't included in. And I would say that the increase in communication with both parents and WISE staff has increased the presence of this third party voicing during cross-system care planning and team meetings, and community meetings.
And in looking at, how do Hayden Rice's teams compare to what a typical team looks like in terms of size, youth, parent, peers, etc.? Or what does the typical look like? Let's do that first.
Based on our policies and procedures as an organization, a typical team includes a therapist, a team being that serving an individual youth, a mental health therapist licensed at either the master's or the doctorate level, a clinical care coordinator licensed through the organization at a bachelor level, a parent peer, and a youth peer. The requirements for the peer roles are much more flexible in our organization, as those are changes that have taken place in the last 6 months to our structure.
And so on Hayden's team, you're the case coordinator.
I am.
The current therapist being Maceo. Does Hayden have a peer?
Hayden does have a peer.
And do I have a peer?
You do have a peer.
Okay. Does the team also involve outside community supports?
It does.
Okay. And on Hayden's team specifically, have there been community supports?
There have.
Consistently?
Yes.
Okay. And is it a single or multiple?
That would depend upon the specific team meeting.
Okay. Would it be fair to say that we have a variety of community supports from both extended family and community on Hayden's team?
It would be fair to say that, yes.
Okay. And what is the purpose of a youth peer?
A youth peer strives to engage with the youth at their level, specifically in areas of interest or competence for that youth. They are, in some ways, a placeholder for natural friendships and relationships, and their work is to lead the youth into greater community involvement.
And for Hayden, that youth peer is Baxter, is that correct?
Baxter Lee, yes.
And I'm sorry, I didn't pick up on that.
The youth peer is Baxter?
Baxter.
And he's in his records as a youth peer. So the records contain notes from each individual that provides services on the intervention, is that correct?
Can you say that again? I apologize.
So in each of these records that we are looking at for Exhibit 343, we've got entries from you, I see Vegeta Stafford, I see records from Cassandra and Baxter, and Marcia. So each person creates their own record based on what they're doing. Is that correct?
Every interaction that we have with a youth or family member or community member is documented as a progress note.
Okay.
Cross-system care plans are the records of our child and family team meetings.
Okay. And it's at those meetings where all of the players kind of come together, as many as possible, to kind of, what is the purpose of that meeting?
those meetings are designed to review our mission that has been set forward, and to problem solve and brainstorm surrounding the strengths of the family and the youth, and how those pertain to the identified prioritized needs and additional unmet needs outlined in the cross-system care plan.
Okay, and so each person on the team has a different part. We talked about Baxter, Hayden's youth peer, kind of engaging him as kind of a surrogate friend sort of person. Is that correct?
It's a rough description, but yes.
you're better with the words than I am. I apologize. And so the parent peer, their role is?
To... it goes from case to case. Generally, the parent peer provides an individual with shared experience to walk alongside of the parent of the identified client, being the youth, during whatever difficulty or crisis the family may have found themselves in that led to their referral to WISE.
And so all referrals to WISE come from some sort of crisis?
They do not. We don't screen. We don't actually screen our clients based on need level, because we are a voluntary service provided for by the state. Our contract mandates that anyone requesting services receive services.
Okay. And in this case, who requested services for Hayden specifically? I guess I'll turn us back to Exhibit 391 on that point.
I no longer have that exhibit.
Okay. May I approach?
You may.
It appears that Hayden Knight signed this form for himself.
And have you observed Hayden sign his signature before? Does that appear to be his signature?
It, from my knowledge, it does appear to be his signature.
Okay. So I did not offer the entire exhibit previously. I'd like to offer the whole exhibit, 391.
Any objections?
Yes, Your Honor. This is a second rewrite of the intake for WISE. I want the original one that was done with DeVita JD.
Objection, that's not in evidence.
I guess I don't understand the objection, Mr. Knight.
The objection is she's trying to get this put in as an original whenever this is was done at her house after changing Hayden's intake when DeVita came over to do an intake with Hayden. He did not sign this. Ms. Voss, this is a second take on this. I want the originals from, this should be in the files from Catholic Community Service provided by DeVita. Whenever she did the intake for Hayden at my house.
Okay, let's pause for a moment. Again, we're on an evidentiary basis.
Okay.
Okay, for the objection. Now, there may be another document. You say an original. And when I talk
yes.
about, when I'm thinking of objections based upon originals, it typically is focused on the accuracy of the document. In other words, best evidence rule. If this is not a accurate copy of the original document. That's what we deal with on originals and evidentiary. I recognize there may be another document out there of similar that may also be admissible that does not relate to this document being admissible.
Okay.
So I understand that argument. You have an evidentiary argument with regard to admissibility of this exhibit.
No objection.
Okay. So with regard to exhibit 391, it is admitted.
Okay. I'm sorry, you see 4821?
Sorry, give me a moment. I am looking at the signature date signed by Hayden on page 3 of the referral form.
I see. I was looking at the first page. It said 4-7.
The referral date, as stated at the top of the referral form, is 4-7-21.
Okay. Can you read the reason for referral on the first page? I'm sorry, can you read that out loud?
Yes. I have been really struggling with communication and being around other people for a while. I am too anxious to talk to new people or to ask for help. My old counselor thought my sibling and I might have autism.
What page was being read?
Following the handouts, there is a filled out form noted as wraparound with intensive services referral form. I am reading from one box up from the bottom. Reason for referral.
I see, thank you.
And so that struggling with communication piece, is that something you have observed?
I have observed that, yes.
Okay, I'm sorry, 4-7-21. So that was a year ago today, is that correct?
I believe that would be correct, yeah.
Okay. And so, have you been working with Hayden for a full year?
I have not.
Okay. So in the time that, do you recall when you started working with Hayden? And I believe if we go to the exhibit 343, that might help.
Yeah.
I believe page 5. The cans signed by you.
Page 5. It is.
Okay, so 2.5, almost 3 months later, he meets you. So you've been with our family, working with our family with this intervention for 9 months?
Approximately.
Okay. So, in the time that you've known Hayden, have you observed him really struggling with communication?
I have observed that, yes.
Okay. Difficulty speaking up?
Yes.
As well as the too anxious to talk to new people, ask for help?
Yes.
Okay. And how does that impact Hayden, that particular challenge? In what domains does that impact him?
I would say that to some extent that question is outside of my specific expertise, as I'm not a licensed mental health therapist.
Mm-hmm.
In my time working with the family, we have identified needs in the domain areas of school, community involvement, and greater friendships.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe the cross-system care plan will reflect goals in each of those areas. I think that's the best I can do to answer that within my role.
Okay. And so when I'm sorry, I keep going between documents here, but if we can go back to 343, your first CANS. What is CANS? What does that stand for?
Child Assessment of Needs and Strengths, or Child Adolescent Needs and Strengths, excuse
okay.
me.
So the communication struggles that Hayden has had, I'm sorry, I'm going to withdraw that. Team meetings, you said you were a little bit more flexible on the parent peer and the youth peer. So every team has to have a case coordinator?
Every team needs a care coordinator, yes.
Okay.
Every team has to have a what?
Care coordinator.
Okay, thank you.
I misspoke. And every team needs a therapist, is that correct?
They do, yes.
Okay. And what are other program requirements in terms of how much time is involved with therapists or team meetings, that sort of thing? What's necessary to keep active within the program?
The program provides a great amount of flexibility within its requirements. The bare minimum for an active case usually is a team meeting occurring once every 30 days. But if a family is at least communicating every 30 days, we are discouraged from closing families and they are considered still open. And we are encouraged to take greater action to schedule the next team meeting.
Okay. And counseling?
The general expectation is 1 hour per week per youth. On the minimum. While this is not a program requirement, it is a program guideline.
Okay. And by my count, looking at these records, I count Hayden had had 12 team meetings through January, and that was the date of the last request. One on 7/8/21, one on 7/22/21, 8/5/21, 8/19/21, 9/2/21, 9/16/21, 10/5/21, 10/22/21, 10/29/21, 12/17/21, so it looks like we missed November there. 11/6/22, 1/20/22. Does that sound about right?
That sounds about right.
Okay. And we've had one team meeting last week.
Yes.
And I believe the month prior, at least one, is that correct?
I believe so.
February. Okay.
Yes.
So at least once a month, and often more. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Okay. And so the record dated 6/21/21 by you, and
Do you have a page number for me?
I'm struggling to find it.
I apologize.
Okay, so Cans is first, and then we, the next record is from Joseph Darrow, dated 5/25, so that was before your Cans. I thought they were entirely in order in terms of the... I can't figure out what page is on, but let me read the citation and see if it rings a bell with you. It says, took over intervention from previous dean. Bob expressed his frustration with the slow start to the WISE process and his need for order regarding visit times, scheduling. Bob recounted the history of the custody and litigations that have been going on for 13 years. Both youths were unwilling to talk or make eye contact with the WISE team. I know this is a hoop I need to jump through. I really think that once we get going, we can see some progress. Schedule first team meeting. Does that sound familiar?
It's page 39, and yes, I see that I wrote that note.
Okay. Thank you. The frustration with a slow start. You indicated previously that there was another case coordinator, Rhea.
Care coordinator, yes.
Thank you. Care coordinator Rhea, and they were, I only see Rhea mentioned in one or two records through all of these. How long was Rhea involved?
I'm not aware.
Okay. And do you know what happened there?
I don't.
Okay. The next progress note, 6/25/21. Which appears to be page 48, I think. My notes say, Bob stated that he's adamantly against team meetings happening while either youth is at mom's house. Bob is starting a new job next week that will restrict call times during the day to 15 minutes and available appointment times after 5 p.m.
Objection, redaction.
Your response.
The record appears incomplete. I agree. I would like to know what the response was to that. I understand that Mr. Knight requested privilege and he requested that these be redacted, and now he's objecting that they're redacted. I will absolutely request that.
Well, this is the quandary. We have a document that's redacted. We have an objection. I don't know if there's a completeness. It appears to be a completeness issue. And now you're asking a witness about a document that's incomplete. And I can't take testimony on a document that needs to be completed. I'm not faulting you for having it where we are, but I don't know how this court can proceed with this line of questioning without dealing with that issue.
Okay. I understand, Your Honor.
But at the same token, I also recognize that the the questioning of a witness oftentimes is a building block approach. And so if you, as a result of the court's ruling, have to move on with this witness, you don't get that block. And so I'm just saying that I'm concerned at this juncture. I don't think it's appropriate to elicit testimony about this document. However, if it affects your ability to elicit testimony on from this witness, then it may be that we have to resolve this issue before you can continue with your questioning. Only you know the answer to that.
Mr. Click, do you know, do you recall what the redacted portion of this record says?
I do not.
Okay. And if we were to require you to request you to bring unredacted copies for at another time, would you be able to do that?
I'm not aware. I'll need to talk to our legal team.
Okay. I'm willing to move on from this page to another line of questioning and attempt to resolve that incompleteness issue.
And again, Ms. Voss, in no way, shape, or form am I attempting to limit your ability to examine this witness to the extent that you think is appropriate. Okay. So if you make a choice to do something else, that is your choice. I'm giving you, I'm just telling you that I am open to dealing with this issue and allowing you to continue with this witness after it's been dealt with. Okay.
Okay.
It's your choice.
Okay. I would like to continue examining the witness on other fronts and come back to this particular issue.
Okay, you may proceed then.
Thank you. So, do you feel that the intervention for Hayden has, I'm sorry, can we go to what are Hayden's goals? And I have the latest team meeting record in a new exhibit.
Thank you. Starting to collect some hands and lap. Yeah, collecting some paper over here.
Are we good with that?
Okay.
May I approach?
Yes.
Thank you.
Did you show up to Mr. Knight?
I didn't sign
okay.
That.
Show up to Mr. Knight first so we know what we're talking about.
Mr. Knight. Recognize that?
Which exhibit number are we looking at?
398.
Thank you.
It is.
Thank you. Do you recognize this?
I do.
And can you identify or describe it for the court?
Yeah, this is a cross-system care plan, as it appears in a system report. This is the cross-system care plan for the date of meeting on 3/31/22. I believe that meeting took place from 4 p.m. until around 5:30 p.m. With a combination of in-person and Zoom attendees.
And has that been kind of the norm, people in the home and people online?
Yes.
For his team meetings?
It has.
Okay. So you went you go over the family vision or the youth's goals fairly frequently in each of these team meetings or other things, is that correct?
In Hayden's intervention, I do frequently go over these, yes.
Okay. And what are some common themes?
The common themes of the goals stated in our cross-system care plan are Hayden gaining relationship with people of similar interest, safety and health, and self-advocacy.
And in the 9 months that you've known Hayden, have you seen growth in these areas?
I have.
At least in the areas that he can control, is that correct? Or within our sphere of control?
I don't think my answer changes with the distinction, but yes.
Okay. And some things are beyond Hayden's control or my control, is that correct? With respect to decision making on this safety front?
Yes.
Okay, so I can't make decisions about what goes on at school, is that correct?
Objection, he has no say in the school. He's a counselor for WISE.
The witness can answer the question to the best of the witness's ability. Overruled.
My understanding of the family is that your input directly to the school is limited, although I'm not entirely sure by which factors.
I'm sorry, let me rephrase the question.
Thank you.
Do I have decision-making about Hayden's education under the parenting plan?
I don't know.
Okay. Do you know if I have medical decision-making, can schedule appointments for him, et cetera?
My understanding is that you do not possess medical decision-making for Hayden.
Okay. And at 13, can Hayden make medical decisions, schedule an appointment, go talk to a doctor on his own?
I'm not a medical professional, as it were, but from my understanding, there is some current debate around what is and what is not his right in that area. It really depends on the topic.
So you're familiar with mental health rights of children with that 13-year threshold?
I am.
And that's pretty much your boathouse or your wheelhouse. I'll try to stay in your lane there.
Thank you.
So I'd like to offer Exhibit 398.
Any objections to 398?
No.
Exhibit number 398 is admitted.
And so at the team meeting, we discussed some good news.
Yes.
Can you tell us about, your notes are always a little vague, so can you elaborate on the major improvements in communication?
During my early, for background, during our meeting, we discussed changes over time, positive changes over time. We usually talk about good news, but from time to time we'll have a team meeting where we review progress and reset our direction. During this specific team meeting, during that conversation, several staff members and team members noted improvements in Hayden's communication and willingness to communicate with others. It was pretty unanimous that Hayden has grown in his comfort around people and his ability to speak up when he needs things.
And I'd like to ask for Exhibit 387, please.
At this juncture, she's just asked for it and hasn't identified it yet, so we'll wait till it's offered.
Do you have one?
I have 398.
Okay. At our previous team meeting on March 3rd, we were going to have an important conversation about some things. Is that correct?
I remember that, yes.
Okay, and while we were about to talk, we were interrupted, weren't we?
Yes.
And who interrupted us?
Hayden.
Is it like Hayden to interrupt people when they're talking?
Not within my experience.
Well, let me back up there. During team meetings, is Hayden verbal and expressive and chatty?
No.
How does he express himself?
Including Hayden's voice in team meetings, usually, comes through a combination of yes-no questions and rating things as satisfactory from 1 to 10 using his fingers. At times Hayden has been more verbal. At times eliciting a nod has been difficult. The team as a whole usually presents things to Hayden. The team being the community and the WISE staff.
And is he the same way? Have you had opportunities to interact with him one-on-one?
I have.
And is he the same?
No.
For example, did you have an opportunity to interact with Hayden, myself, and Rice playing a game?
I have, yeah.
And was he verbal and articulate at that point?
Yes.
And so, is there a significant contrast between how Hayden presents in certain situations or on certain topics?
Yes.
And so we've got the one extreme where hard to get a thumbs up, and the other extreme where how expressive was he playing the game?
Very.
Was he very determined to prove a point in the game?
He was.
And the game being, can you just briefly describe the game?
Yeah, the game that I believe you're referring to took place earlier this week at an appointment. The game was titled Super Fight, I think. And it's a game in which opponents verbally spar with the character that they are given. It's a bit of a strategy game, a bit of a logic game, but it relies entirely on verbal communication and creativity.
And in that aspect, would you say he absolutely excelled?
I would, yeah.
And then the other aspect with the team meeting, pretty much the opposite side of the spectrum. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Okay. And turning back to this exhibit 397, what is in this first and second photo?
This is a picture of Alma's cake mix in pink. The second picture appears to be the ingredients of some cake mix.
Okay. And do you recognize, did you look at the package on the day in question on March 3rd, the prior team meeting?
I did not.
Who was this cake mix involved in some respect in our prior team meeting on March 3rd?
Cake mix was involved. I did not see the package.
Okay. And who did?
Rice and Cassandra prepared the cupcakes that were made from presumably this mix.
Okay.
Hayden later looked at the package, and I don't recall whether or not you saw the package, which you took pictures, so I can assume that you did see the package.
Right. And so, can you describe what happened during the March 3rd meeting with respect to cupcakes?
Yeah. So the team meeting concluded around the hour mark. It had been previously discussed that while Cassandra, the parent peer, was over at the house in order to give me greater margin to talk with Hayden about goals, Cassandra would bake cupcakes with Rice. The cupcakes were baked, and I believe the portion of the event that you are talking about would be that Hayden did have some of one of these cupcakes and had a said he was having a reaction and indicated that he was in need of an EpiPen.
Okay. So Hayden interrupted us, and he said he had some symptoms. Is that correct?
Yes.
I'd like to show you an emergency care plan, and we can discuss symptoms next. Can I get exhibits 363?
Yes, you may.
Okay, so 346.
This appears to be a recheck that took place at Northwest Asthma and Allergy Center in Seattle.
Okay, and I'm going to see if we can find an emergency plan from Northwest Asthma and Allergy within this record.
Objection, Your Honor. This is all medical documentation, and Mr. Click is a care coordinator for Wise Counseling, who don't even have a psychology degree. How is his representation of anything that the doctor has put forward relevant?
Well, I think that Ms. Voss, we've dealt with foundational issues before in these type of records, and so at this point she hasn't offered. And I will hear what foundation is raised if that's her intention. I guess it's foundation established, not raised. I'm sorry, what number?
63 from the original. Another emergency care plan from 2017, is that correct?
What exhibit number are you looking to right now?
Sorry, I was talking while I was scrambling. 367?
367, okay. Just give me a moment to pull it. Proceed.
Thank you. seen a document, this or similar document. I'm sorry, can you identify this record?
This is a record produced by Northwest Asthma and Allergy Center in Seattle for the identified patient Hayden T. Knight. It is a school food allergy emergency plan.
And when Hayden came to us expressing symptoms on March 3rd, we've got different boxes of different kinds of symptoms on this plan. We've got severe symptoms on the top, and we've got mild symptoms on the bottom. Is that correct? And
you need to use words.
Yes.
Thank you.
I apologize.
And which, do you recall which of the symptoms he was expressing?
I remember that he reported having an itchy mouth. He, if I remember correctly, reported feeling weird. I do not remember which other symptoms he reported.
Okay. And when he shared those symptoms, what did I do?
I don't recall specifically.
Okay. Did I pull out a plan like this?
Whether that happened before or after Hayden reported his symptoms, I don't remember, but I do remember seeing this plan during, or a similar plan, I apologize, during that time.
Okay. And is this a plan that we talked about previously? Or this or a similar plan?
Yes.
Okay. And so with the symptoms that Hayden was reporting, was he confident in what he needed?
He was.
Okay. And was he able to get himself an EpiPen?
He was not.
Didn't he ask for me to do it?
He did.
And after Hayden received the epinephrine, or the EpiPen, I'm sorry, did I inject the EpiPen?
You did.
Okay. And after being injected, was he having a heart attack or clearly damage from the use of epinephrine?
I don't believe that's within my field of specialty to say.
Sure. Did he appear to be improving or worsening?
Improving somewhat.
Okay. So you called 911, is that correct?
I did, yes, at your request.
And you were not present in the home when paramedics were there?
I was not.
Okay. And so at that following team meeting, did I express my thanks to the team for helping Hayden be confident in what his body was telling him?
You did.
So was I thankful that they helped him advocate in a moment when it meant the most?
I believe you said something to that effect, yes.
Do you feel that Hayden's choice to solicit live services was a wise choice?
Yes. can't say.
But you've seen growth.
I have.
I'm sorry, what was the last part?
But you've seen growth?
I have.
Okay, and in this moment, he was able to communicate and get his needs met. Is that correct?
He was able to communicate in need, yes, and receive what he was asking for.
Okay. I gave you three exhibits. Can you remind me what the third one was?
You gave me 367, 346, and 355.
Okay, 355 being the Pioneer School District records. I'd like to offer that exhibit 367.
Basis of objection?
Under testimony, he was just saying that he had seen it. There's numerous ones. That is not the most up-to-date one. There is more up-to-date of that type.
You have a foundation issue right now. I'm going to I'll give you the opportunity to further develop foundation, but you need to lay a foundation on this if you're able to with this witness.
I don't know that I am able to with this witness. I think I will have to go through them all.
I'll sustain the objection.
I'm sorry, Mr. Click, how could you identify which plan you have looked at previously? What would it take for you to be certain that, yes, this is the one we looked at or we talked about?
Based on the number of attachments and documents that have been presented to me, I'm not entirely sure that there's a sufficient way for me to identify what I have and haven't seen.
Right. Okay. And if, for example, we were to pull out the emergency plan that Hayden carries in his emergency kit, would that be one way for you to be certain?
I don't have knowledge of who has access to that kit or where it goes or if the plan that I saw on the 3rd came from that kit or not. So I don't believe that would be sufficient for me to identify.
Right. Be pretty challenging, wouldn't it? Okay, thank you. Exhibit 355. We have 149 of 149?
This is the exhibit that's mixed up. The numbers don't coincide correctly. We went over this previous.
Are you able to locate number 49 of 149?
Mine goes 141 and then jumps to, or goes 146 and then jumps back to 129.
Right.
And then
I believe though the first numbers begin with number 13 and they go sequential to 49. Before they start skipping backwards. If you just check on that.
Page 58 jumps to 141, goes up to 146, jumps to 129, and then goes up to 132. I cannot locate 149.
We're looking at number 49 of 149.
I cannot be able to locate that page. You said 149 of 149?
No, it's number 49 of 149.
49.
Is that correct,
okay.
Ms. Voss?
It is.
Thank you.
Okay, sorry.
Okay, we're on the same page, literally. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. Can you identify this document as well?
This is a document produced by the organization FAIR, Food Allergy Research and Education, titled Food Allergy and Anaphylaxis Emergency Care Plan for the named patient, Hayden Knight, and signed by someone in the year 2018.
I'm sorry, the year?
2018, I apologize.
And so we've got severe symptoms, mild symptoms, pretty similar to the other plan we looked at, is that correct?
This document is similar, yes.
Okay, and at the top, and we didn't discuss this in the prior exhibit, but at the top, we've got some boxes checked where it says extremely reactive to the following, with milk products being identified there. Therefore, and the boxes direct us to give epinephrine whether or not severe symptoms exist. Is that correct?
That box is checked on this form, yes.
Right, so it's any symptoms if likely eaten. Is that correct?
Yes.
And then the next line is if the allergen was definitely eaten, even if there are no symptoms apparent, that's checked.
It is.
And that's based on the milk allergy, is that correct?
Objection. The witness is not a doctor. He don't know what it's actually based on. He can only read what the paper states.
At this juncture, you're identifying a document. You've kind of gone beyond identifying a document. You're laying a foundation, now you're asking them to testify about the document that has not been admitted.
Okay.
So I will, at this point, sustain the objection because you're asking questions about inside a document that has not been admitted.
Okay.
Okay, so if you wish to lay a foundation to admit this document, you can attempt to do so.
Okay. I believe exhibit 355 was admitted.
Okay, let me take a look.
23rd.
And that solves that issue. And so I take back everything I just said about having reviewing a document that's not been admitted. Okay. So given that this document has already been admitted, Mr. Knight, what's your objection?
My objection is that Mr. Click is a care coordinator for WISE program. This is a medical documentation from 2018 that was done by a doctor. There has been multiples done since then, and it's as the care of a child and a doctor's goes through, these things are adjusted. And if Ms. Voss wants to just pick out which one she wants to follow, then that isn't appropriate. So Mr. Click can testify about counseling of the WISE program, but I don't see how he can testify anything about a medical issue that a doctor has prescribed and we've been dealing with ourselves.
Okay, so Ms. Voss is able to ask a witness a question about what a document reads when she gets to the point where she's asking the witness an opinion about the document. That may be an issue that can be addressed. But at this juncture, she's only asked what the document says. So at this juncture, I'm going to overrule the objection.
Thank you, Your Honor. And have you and Hayden and I reviewed this or similar plan, not unlike the other exhibit we just looked at, in regard to when to epi?
We have.
Okay, and so at Hayden's, I believe it was the CANS assessment for the WISE program, he identified not feeling safe in school. Is that correct?
I don't recall if that's recorded on his CANS.
Okay. I guess we'll have to go back to that. That would have to be whether it's a CANS or another safety and supervision plan. I'm going to have to try to figure out which exhibit that was.
Do this while you're looking for that document. It's almost 3:30, so we're going to take our afternoon recess. So we'll regroup. We'll come back on the record at 3:45. You can step down. Courts are recessed.
Thank you, sir.